to Timor. It was November 12, 1991 that I want to talk about today, 20 years ago. 17 years before that, on December 7, 1975, Indonesia invaded the small island nation called East Timor. They raided by land, by air, and by sea a day after then President Ford and Secretary of State Henry Kissinger met with the long-reigning dictator Suharto, gave the go-ahead for the invasion. 90% of the weapons used were from the United States. Indonesia then closed East Timor to the outside world, and for the next 17 years, they slaughtered the population. They killed off a third of the population, a genocide worse than Pol Pot's Cambodia. I got a chance to go to Timor in 1990 and 91 with my colleague Alan Nairn. In 91, he was writing for the New Yorker magazine. I was doing a documentary for Pacifica Radio. On November 12th, early in the morning, the people in Dili, the capital of East Timor, gathered at the church. They were mourning yet another young man killed by the Indonesian military. His name was Sebastio Gomez. They went to mass in the morning about 6 o'clock, thousands of people. The mass was so big, the priests had to go outside to perform communion. And then the people went into the streets to march to the Santa Cruz Cemetery, overflowing with the bodies of young and old at the cemetery. Too many people killed in the prime of their life because of the occupation. Unfortunately, an occupation that was facilitated, that was armed, that was financed by the United States. Thousands of people marched through the streets of Dili, through this geography of pain, where in every other building, whether it was a hotel where Timorese were tortured at the back, or an officer's home where Timorese women were raped, or police stations where Timorese were held, or military barracks where they were tortured and disappeared, the people marched through their streets, thousands of them, girls in their traditional, women in their traditional Timorese garb, girls in their Catholic school uniforms, thousands joined. They were exhilarated. They were daring to march together as one in a land where there was no freedom of assembly, no freedom of press, no freedom of speech. And they all put their hands up in the V sign as they marched from the Catholic Church to the cemetery, shouting, Viva East Timor, Viva Independence. When they got to the cemetery about 8 in the morning, Alan and I were interviewing people in the road. We were saying, why are you risking your life? They would say, for my mother or my father, for my village, it was wiped out. And then from the direction the procession had come, came hundreds of Indonesian soldiers carrying their US M16s at the ready position. We know the soldiers had committed many massacres in the past, but never in front of Western journalists. So we went to the front of the crowd. The people couldn't escape. There were high walls on either side for the cemetery. Only people at the back could run away. I took out my equipment, which I had always hid, because anyone caught talking to a Western journalist could be hurt, could be disappeared, could be taken. I slung my tape recorder over my shoulder. I put up my microphone like a flag. Alan put the camera above his head. We walked to the front of the crowd. The soldiers marched up 10 to 12 abreast. They swept around the corner without any warning, without any provocation, without any hesitation. They swept past us and they opened fire on the crowd, gunning people down from right to left. On that day, they killed more than 250 Timorese. They threw me to the ground, beating me with their rifle butts in their boots. And Alan got a photograph of them opening fire, but he threw himself on top of me to protect me from further injury, and they took their US M16s like baseball bats and they slammed them against his skull until they fractured it. As we lay on the ground, Alan covered in blood, the soldiers put the guns to our heads and they were screaming two things, Australia and politique. Politique, they were saying, we were political to witness this, but that is our job as journalists, to go to where the silence is. And they were shouting Australia. They wanted to know if we were from Australia, and we knew how dangerous that was. 17 years before, when Indonesia invaded Timor, there were 6 Australian-based journalists who were covering the invasion. 5 of them, the Indonesian military caught. They lined them up against a house, and they executed them. The head of that operation that killed the Australian-based journalist later became the Minister of Information of Indonesia. The 6th, named Roger East, was in a radio station in Dili, and as he reported to the world what was happening in Timor the day after the invasion, it was December 8th, 1975, they dragged him out of the radio station as he shouted, I'm from Australia, they shot him into the harbor with so many thousands of Timorese. The Australian government hardly protested the killing of their journalists. We believe because years later, Australia and Indonesia would sign the Timor Gap Treaty, which divided up Timor's oil between Australia and Indonesia. Oil is the source of so much pain in the world. So 17 years later, as we lay on the ground, Alan covered in blood, we shouted back, no, we're from America, America. They stripped us now of everything. The only thing I had left was my passport. I threw it at them. I was born in Washington, D.C., adding a little more even to the American passport. They would kick me in the stomach. When I get my breath back, I'd say, America, America. Ultimately, they took the guns from our heads. We believe because we were from the same country their weapons were from. They would have to pay a price for killing us. They'd never had to pay for killing the Timorese. And the soldiers moved on. When we got to the hospital, a Red Cross Jeep pulled up. We were able to get into it, and dozens of Timorese threw themselves on top of us, on top of the van, hanging off of the spare tire at the back. We drove as a human mass to the hospital as they were trying to escape the killing field. The doctors and nurses started to cry when they saw us, not because we were in worse shape than the Timorese. The incredibly brave Timorese were dragging in their friends, sisters, brothers, those who had not yet died, to try to get them operated on, to try to save them. But I think we represented two things that day to the Timorese, the sword and the shield. The sword, because all too often the U.S. government either provides weapons to human rights abusing regimes like Indonesia, or uses the weapons themselves in Afghanistan and Pakistan and Iraq. But that's the U.S. government. They see the American people in a very different way, as the shield, the most powerful shield that has the only ability to turn those weapons back, to send the weapons flow back. And that day, they saw that shield bloodied, and it just deepened their despair. We were able to get out of the country that day, on the one flight out of East Timor. When we got back to Washington, well, we made a call in Bali that there had been a massacre in Timor. We were able to get on a flight, came back to Washington, held a news conference at the National Press Club explaining it was U.S. weapons that were used. And in this massacre, more than 270 Timorese died. It was not one of the larger massacres in East Timor. A nationwide movement grew up, spearheaded by the East Timor Action Network, educating people about what was happening. Noam Chomsky talked about East Timor in almost every address he gave back from 1975 until they achieved their freedom. A nationwide movement grew up. And in 1999, the people of East Timor got to vote for their freedom. 3 years after the massacre, by the way, Alan and I went back to Indonesia. They declared us a threat to national security in the Indonesian parliament for having survived and witnessed the massacre. But on this third anniversary, Clinton was heading to Jakarta for the APEC summit, as is happening this weekend. And the Indonesian military announced Alan and I could return to show how open Indonesia was. It was now. It was the anniversary of the massacre, so we attempted to get back into Timor, and the Indonesian military caught us and arrested us. But because Clinton was about to land, it was causing too much of an international kerfuffle, and so they released us. 1999, I attempted to get in for the vote in East Timor. The Indonesian military caught me. They deported me twice, but Alan did get in to East Timor. And as the people of East Timor voted for their freedom, the Indonesian military burned East Timor to the ground in a sadistic goodbye operation to the people of East Timor. And in this last fell swoop, killing more than 1,000 Timorese as the final blow. They voted overwhelmingly for their freedom. 3 years later, after the UN oversaw the transition, on May 20th, 2002, the people of East Timor celebrated their independence. I was able to get in that day to cover them coming through Australia, and it was a remarkable scene. And we broadcast this night, this historic night, the only U.S. broadcaster, Pacifica Radio, from East Timor for the birth of a new nation. And it was just about midnight. Kofi Annan, the UN, former UN Secretary General, gave his speech. Many world leaders and dignitaries were there on the stage. And then Xanana Gusmao, the rebel leader of Timor, long imprisoned by Indonesia, the founding president of a new Timor, got up and he unfurled the flag of the Democratic Republic of East Timor. There was this fireworks display, and you could see the light reflected in the tear-stained faces of the Timorese. Over 100,000 people had gathered on this night. This nation of survivors had prevailed. They had resisted and they had won at an unbelievably high price, at an unacceptably high price. 200,000 Timorese had been killed, but ultimately they won. And they thank people from all over the world, especially from the most powerful, from the Western nations who had told their governments to stop arming human rights abusing regimes. And it is a lesson to us here. Whether we are journalists or librarians, whether we're doctors, nurses, students, professors, whether we're business people, whether we are artists, whether we are activists, employed or unemployed, we have a decision to make every day, every hour of every day, and that is whether to represent the sword or the shield. Democracy Now!